Well, at the very core of the gospel, the good news of Jesus is this message that's unlike every major religion on the planet. You know that, right? And is this, that there is nothing that we can do to earn our way into relationship with God. It is literally grace through faith. And we get access to God because of the obedient life, death, resurrection of Jesus, which I love. And y'all, we deserved something totally different. But we got grace. And that grace given to us by the great love of God the Father was greater than. It was greater than our past, it was greater than our sin. It was greater than how arrogant you and I have been or how far we've run. It's greater than the way that we have treated people in the past. I can't believe we would even do that. It's greater than the hurts and the pains that have been done to us. The grace of Jesus is greater. And Kyle said it last week that Jesus didn't teach about grace. But it's so funny because you can't read Jesus and not see, you can't see his life and not see story after story after story of grace. And my favorite thing about that is it didn't matter to him who people were. It didn't matter if you were rich, if you were poor. It didn't matter to him if you were over-religious or if you were just the worst sinner on the planet. It didn't matter if you were an adulterer, if you were a murderer. It didn't matter if you were just boring like the rest of us. Jesus' grace was always greater. And last week, if you were here, you got to hear story after story just of grace. And Kyle sprung that 6-minute video that made everybody weep. And my wife and I, you know, we were literally sitting there, and I think my wife and her friend went through like a box of Kleenex. And there's a few misty-eyed fellows in the room as well. But last week, we were all amazed. Why? Because there's something about a story of grace. There's something about listening to and hearing the way that God intercepts people's lives. And for many of us, grace has come to us. And it intersected our lives. And if it hasn't, man, I pray this is true for you. And so for me, I'm a little nerdy and I've got this little pamphlet because God's grace has come to me. And so I've got this little pamphlet. It's like the 33 things that happen at the moment that you have received salvation. Okay, it's just like a scriptural study that kind of tells you what happened to you the moment that you stepped into grace. So I'll be a little nerdy for a second. I'll just read some of those things. I have to remind myself all the time that we have been redeemed, that we've been reconciled, that we are now the children of God, that God is our Father, that we've been adopted as sons and daughters. We are literally a part of the family of God. Y'all, heaven's our home. We've been forgiven. We've been freed from our past. We've been freed from the law. We have no more distance. We've been accepted. We've been brought near to him. We've been delivered from the power of darkness, transplanted into the kingdom of the Son. We are a royal priesthood, a chosen generation, a holy nation, a people that belong to God. We are somehow the saints. The light of God lives inside of us. We have oneness with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We've been born again, justified, glorified, sealed by the Spirit, filled with the Spirit. And I promise you, there is nothing that we need that we don't have in Christ. Is there anything greater than the grace of God to us? I don't think so. And I'm telling you, we could just stop right there. We have every single thing that we need. But here's what I love about grace. Grace just keeps going. And here in a minute, I want to kind of unpack a story from Jesus' life and a story of grace. But at first, I want to kind of show you some things that I saw in my study for this and my preparation for teaching the sermon I was digging in for today. And so here's what I did. I took every New Testament passage on grace and I cut them into strips and I put them out on a table. And I just wanted to see, right? I know it looks like a bad hoarders episode is what that looks like. But I just wanted to see grace. I just want to see how it intersects with the church. I want to see it in the lives of people. And as I looked at it, it was just super interesting because I saw some things I never noticed. For example, and I kind of should have known this, but grace was in the intro of almost every single epistle. Isn't that interesting? And then not only that, but it was almost in every single closing line. And so I'll give you an example. I mean, we're only talking about, you know, Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, 1 and 2 Peter, 2 John, and even Revelation. They all open with, grace and sometimes in peace or just grace. Grace, don't miss this, to you. And then they end like this, and it's super interesting. And again, there's a little bit of a variation for it, but it's the grace of the Lord Jesus be grace with either you or grace with us or grace with God's people. Amen. By the way, this is the very last line of the New Testament. And I just thought that was kind of interesting, don't you? That there's grace at the beginning of every story, and grace at the end. And it's almost as if the gospel writers just wanted to just kind of scream out to us and just say, hey, this grace has come to you. And if you know the early church, you know that when the grace came to them, as they wrote, everything got messy in the middle, right? Like grace didn't just come to them, but grace then started to work in them. But then the gospel writers, you can just feel them say, but then, listen, grace has to move through you. And I love that. Grace doesn't stop. Grace at the beginning, grace in the middle, grace literally until the end. So let's just dig into one of my favorite stories. It's out of Mark chapter 2. And Jesus was headed back into a town called Capernaum. And Capernaum was where Peter was from. And me and a group of about 70 people up here just went down. And we were in Capernaum. And as we were there, they kind of have homes. And they're really complicated. And Jesus used to live there. He had a house there. Peter had a house. And the last time Jesus was in town, he was just in town a few days ago. His house was so packed, everybody wanted a piece of Jesus that everybody just wanted to see him. He had to wait till midnight, late night. He had to slip away and say, hey, look, I got to go preach other places. That's where I came. But now he's back in town. And guess what? House is packed again. And so we find at the beginning of the story, it says this. It says, some men came bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. So this is a story of grace, and this is how it happens. There's a man who needs grace. He's a paralytic. So I don't know if you know much about paralytics, but paralytics in the year 2017, it's pretty complicated. Not a lot of options, but you just back that train up about 2,000 years, and you talk about helpless, you talk about hopeless, you talk about a guy who's out of options. And it's even worse. Because see, they had this stigma back then in the culture that they had, and it was this thing. If you're broken, if there's something wrong with you, if something tragic's happened to you, then guess what? I mean, we hate it for you, but you probably did something to deserve it. And so in the middle of this man's helplessness, he also felt the eyes of every person that walked by and felt the guilt, felt the shame. This man needed grace. So four men, we don't know, there might have been more, but at least four carried him. They kind of hop into the scene. We don't know much about them. You know, were they neighbors? I don't know. Were they family members? Were they former coworkers? We really don't know, but we do know that these men decided we're gonna act. And so they literally, they come in and they put him on a mat and they pick him up and they start heading towards Jesus. But my question is why? And so here's kind of the way maybe this went down. I mean, maybe in their little town, we don't know where they were from, but maybe they had started to hear these little stories about Jesus, about this Jesus who did these incredible things. And at first, if you don't know this whole Jesus thing, you'd never met him before, you're like, that's a little far-fetched, don't you think? Brother, there's no way that happened. I mean, there's no way, that's crazy. But then something tells me that one, maybe two of the guys said, let's go check it out. And so they go, and I don't know, and I'm reading this into the text, but I can't help but think that one or two of them ran into Jesus. And when they did, they realized that this Jesus can do things nobody else can do. So when these men come back into town, what would you do? When you've experienced that kind of grace, when you've seen what it could be like, and you see, well, when you come back, you don't see what everybody else sees. Everybody else sees somebody that's out of options. There's no hope for this guy. But these men see a situation that doesn't have to be that way. Because we just met a guy who can do what nobody else can do. And you, fellas, all we need to do, I mean, he's here. Jesus is there. He can, let's just close the distance. Let's get this guy to Jesus. And so they take off. And I love this in verse 4. It says this. It says, they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd. And so they start off and everybody's excited and let's do this. You know, and they pick him up and they start heading to Jesus. As soon as we get there, it's gonna be great. But when they get there, there's a problem. They can't get in. And what we know from other accounts is that inside of the house, it was actually a lot of religious people. Imagine that. Jesus in the middle and a bunch of religious people in the center and the broken people can't even get in. And you can kind of get a little stereotype about what they thought of broken people at the time, because the broken people are standing outside saying, hey, say, can we just get in? Can we just, and they're like, please get out of here. So what do you do? What do you do if you've had an experience with grace and you know that there's a Jesus can do what only Jesus can do and you're stopped short? You have a setback. I love these guys. They you know, literally, finish Mark 4, it says they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it. So if you can just picture this, the house is packed with all these important religious leaders, everybody's heroes inside, and these guys say, well, they scramble up the side of the house like some hill jacks, and they just start running across the roof, and they roll up their sleeves, and they start digging through the ceiling. And don't you kind of want to know what was going through their mind at this time? Is that just me? Because I'm sitting there going, okay, at least two of these guys just got talked into this, right? At least two of them. And they're standing up there and like, bro, time out, all right? Like, it's one thing that we gave up time. Like, I shouldn't even be here. My wife, there's so much stuff that I should be doing right now. I'm missing my kid's ball game. My wife's gonna kill. What are we doing? And then it's not just that, but then we get here and now we're cutting a hole in somebody's roof. And I don't know if you know about roofs in the early, you know, first century, but they're kind of like roofs now. You need a roof. And when you cut holes in roofs, it costs money to fix roofs. And somebody's doing math going, hey, who's paying for this, man? Are you paying? Somebody's gonna have to pay for this. But there's another cost. Because see, they're digging a hole. I mean, they're interrupting this gathering of some of the most important people in town that everybody looks up and respects to. I mean, these guys, what are they gonna think of us? I mean, what are they gonna think of us digging? Like, who does this? But I love this because there's something about these men where no inconvenience of time was gonna keep them from tearing a hole in that ceiling. There's no amount of money that was gonna keep them from busting through that ceiling. As a matter of fact, there was no loss of reputation that day that was gonna keep them from busting through that ceiling. They were gonna get him to Jesus. And if you're gonna just imagine, I can, you know, like, I just love seeing this. I picture things in my mind and I can just picture these really important people and everybody around. And then all of a sudden you see the roof and you hear, and there's cloud and there's dust and there's smoke and everybody's going, you know, something's coming through the roof and you're going, what is going on right now? But then the dust clears and there he is at the feet of Jesus. And I love this line. It's one of my favorite lines. It says, when Jesus saw their faith. I don't know if you know the story, but what started in grace and someone recognizing, now he's at the feet of Jesus and he gets everything he needs. First thing he does, Jesus looks at him and says, son, your sins are forgiven. And when he says that, everybody in the room just kind of looks, because here's the thing, grace to you is invisible, right? Nobody can see when grace comes to you. And so Jesus says, I know it's invisible and I know you don't understand that I can actually even do that. And he says, but because, so you'll know, why don't you stand up and walk? And the guy pops up and starts walking. And everybody just goes, wow, he just received grace through faith. But it's funny, like I wanted the passage to say Jesus saw his faith. Doesn't it seem like that? Like Jesus saw his faith and he responded to his faith, but that's not what it says in the text. It says when Jesus saw their faith. And I just think it's interesting to me that while grace to this man was completely invisible, grace through these men that from a distance found someone who needed grace, put sacrifice, put energy, put effort, brought him down in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw that, it wasn't invisible. It was visible, it was powerful, and it moved Jesus to action. And I love this because the passage says, this amazed everyone. And they praise God saying, we've never seen anything like this. And that's what a story of grace does. It makes us sit up. It makes us lean forward. It makes us say, that's my Jesus. That's what I'm talking about. That is incredible. And so I just sit there as everybody walked away that day. And I wonder who walked away the most changed. My heart wants to say the paralytic, right? Because he's the one that, I mean, he couldn't walk, and now he's got healing, he's got transformation, he's got forgiveness, and he's walking out that door. But I don't know. Because there's another group of guys who, like I said, they experienced the grace of Jesus, they acted on the grace of Jesus, they've gone through sacrifice, they dig a hole in the roof no matter what it costs, they put this person in front of Jesus, and then Jesus actually does what we thought he was gonna do. Can you believe that? It's kind of like this. My wife isn't sure what she thinks about this, but she just turned 40 last weekend, all right? Big 4-0. I know it's scary. And this is her, and this is a great description of her life, just full, right? Like, you know, don't judge us. We chose four. He was a surprise, but it's awesome. Awesome. Best surprise of our lives, right? And my wife, I just love her. And so I just decided to talk her out for a night on the town with some close friends. And she was like, finally. So we went to this cute little French American bistro. You know, the place that all you men really want to go to. And with just a small group of people, and we reserved an upper room because we're super spiritual. Not really. They just have it. And so we went up there, and around there, everybody was around the table, and friends and people we love, and we were just a couple people missing. But we sit there, and they kind of went around, and we just had a great time. And one of our friends said, hey, let's take some time, and let's go around, and let's tell stories about how much Sarah means to us. If you knew my wife, her face just gets red. She hates attention. I said, just don't tell her that I'm sharing this. Like, she just hates to be the center of attention. And so they start to kind of go around the circle, right? And this story's funny and sweet, and it's been great. But there's a story that kind of hit me right at the end. And there's, you all know, there's nothing better than to hear people say things about the people that you love that you see in them. But this one was different. She got there and she said it was kind of a couple that we know and that we've loved. They're about 10 years younger than us. And years and years ago, probably 7-8 years, I don't know how long, we kind of started a small group with some younger couples. We just wanted to live life and invest and pour. And we knew we'd get something out of it too. And so we just invested in them. And we just learned to love them and spend time. And so every week they came over to that house. Every week we had a meal. And I just kind of listened to her as she just shared and talked about how much Sarah meant to her. She talked about how special it had been to watch her as a mom and a wife and watch her with the kids and to watch, you know, to sit at the dinner table, you know, every night and just share meals with us and hang out and laugh. We'd stay up till like 11 o'clock at night, and she remembers the conversations at the sink and the transparency, and she just said, you'll never know what that meant to us and how it's changed us. But then the conversation turned a little bit, and she said, you know, when we started having young couples over to our house. Like, we had received grace to us. We'd received someone like stepping in and showing us even more of what that looks like. And then all of a sudden, it started growing us, and we just decided, and they did, we're gonna go out and we're just gonna leverage and see what God wants to do through us. She said, you and I realized when we first started our first group, it's a lot of work. She said, you know, you realize, I didn't realize you gotta clean the house every single week. Like, and on top of that, they come over and it's great and we love them and it's for it, but they eat a lot of food and it's really expensive to feed that many people around the table. And then we love it and everybody's over there till 11, but when you have little kids and it's 11 o'clock, you're like, yo, I love you, but you gotta leave. And she said, and then I walk in and there's, you know, and I just never thought there's like a mountain of dishes in the sink and the whole next day I'm spending. And she just said, It wasn't until then that we really realized the gift that we had received. Isn't that true? You know, parents, you know that. Some of you parents in the room, you were terrible kids. You were terrible. Your parents should have a badge of honor for raising you. I know some of you. And it wasn't until you became a parent and you poured your life out into these ungrateful little, these amazing little gifts from Jesus, right? It wasn't until you sacrificed, poured your life into them that you understood the gift of grace, what? That was given to you. But now all of a sudden, it means so much more, doesn't it? You know, I think that's a glimpse of what happened with those men this day. It's a picture of grace that somehow, greater than the original grace. Is that possible? And I just sit there, and one of my favorite things, grace to us, beautiful, powerful, makes us go, wow. Grace in us, messy, but all the more beautiful, but grace through us. You know, one of my favorite things in life is watching others that have been far from God have a run-in with grace. You know, and Kyle and I, we were grabbing a new workout place and we got all signed up and you know, the first day, probably not the first day, I'm lying, like fourth day, because I'm ADD. Like fourth day I walk in, I'm like, okay, Jesus, we need to have eyes like you. And so we're here, we're already here, and so would you just show us somebody that needs grace? Would you show us somebody that you have eyes for, somebody that needs you? Because, man, it's so hard, we're so busy, it's hard for us to see that. And that day, I ran into a guy named Colton. Now, Colton wasn't a paralytic, he's kind of the opposite. Colton's a studly dude, he's handsome, and he's put together, and he was training for MMA at the time, which paralytic, you see the gap. And somehow in between there, we picked up a relationship pretty quick, and he's a great guy. But here's what I recognized pretty quickly. I realized that, somebody needs to close the gap between Colton and Jesus. And only Jesus can give him what he needs. And I knew we were gonna need some help to get there. So I grabbed a couple young guys and said, "Hey, I met a guy. And if you guys are in there, man, just let's find a way to get Colton to Jesus. Let's just pray him up. Let's just figure out what happens." And I'm just gonna tell you, we ran into some challenges along the way. Here's some of the challenges. Life is crowded and busy, right? It's crowded and busy for him. Crowded and busy for me. He had a girlfriend, he had a life that he was figuring out, he had some stuff in his past. I have 5 kids, I have a complicated, life, and I've got stuff in my past. But somewhere in the middle of those obstacles, I kept feeling like we were so close. I kept hearing, but it just seemed like right when we were just outside the door, we'd have another setback. And I'll never forget being with some of the guys. A lot of these guys are in the room right now. Remember being with them, we were talking about Colton, and one of the guys that just loved me is just like, "Man, that's it. Colton's coming to Jesus." I'm like, "Okay." He's like, no, it's happening now. Like, we love Colton too much. He's a great guy. He's like, it's happening. It's going down. And I'm like, okay. I'm in. And so he's just full court press and praying, and I'm not gonna lie, a few weeks later, I don't know how much later, Colton ran into grace, and he was baptized right there. Isn't that cool? Yeah. And grace came to him. And I started watching grace work in him. And it wasn't, I'm telling you, it might have barely been a month later when one of Colton's friends runs up to me in the gym. And he's like, I like beeline. I walk in and you can tell when somebody's like, and I'm like, "Hey." And he runs up, he goes, "Bro." And I'm like, "Bro." Gym talk, I guess. And he goes, "Dude, I just wanted to say thank you for pouring into Colton, because you don't even know, man. Colton and a bunch of the fellas, they've hopped into my life and they've changed my life. I'm totally different." And I said, really, what's going on? He said, and he just told me a story of how far he was from God and how these fellas had made up the gap. He told me about some obstacles that were in his life, and he then told me about how the fellas were helping him undo those obstacles and how they finally helped him break through that ceiling of disbelief. And if you watch, y'all have probably noticed it if you've been in the 11:15 service. They just keep baptizing friend after friend after friend. And I can't help but think that maybe this is just one, there's a lot of the pictures of the greatness of the grace of God. That his grace has come to us at great cost and sacrifice. The grace would grow in us, and that grace has to come through us. That once that faith that was invisible would become visible to others because it's through us. I love the way that 1 Peter 4:10 says it. It says, each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. And so I have a question for you, brothers and sisters. Who needs grace in your life right now? Maybe they're not a paralytic, but it's pretty likely that whoever it is has very little to offer you. Who needs grace in your life? Because when grace comes to you, and for a lot of you it has, and as grace moves in you, I just want to challenge you, it has to come through you. That's what grace does. Grace closes the distance. You know, people are distant from God for a whole bunch of reasons, right? Some of them are bitter from the past. Some of them are hurt from the past. Some of them, y'all, they just don't know. But they're distant, and there's some that are even close to you. Some of them are sleeping in your own bed or in your house. And I don't know, maybe you could close the distance by striking up a relationship with them so that they can really see what it looks like to be a believer and to see what grace looks like. We're not perfect, but just see what this grace looks like in somebody's life. Maybe you could get a group of people and say, hey, you know what? I'm not very good at this, but I know this guy, and I know this guy needs to get to Jesus. Can I get some help? Can some of you help some other believers? Like, let's get this dude to Jesus. Let's get this girl to Jesus. Or maybe it's a little bit more personal. Maybe it's time to forgive that person that it's been just impossible for you to forgive. Maybe it's time to accept that person that it's just been impossible for you to accept, because in your forgiveness, in your acceptance, you could start them down the road to closing the gap between them and Jesus. That's what grace does. Grace overcomes obstacles. So I'm just gonna be super blunt, just real fast. I just wanna say, brothers and sisters, we have got to stop giving up on people. We've got to stop giving up. We've got to start recognizing that when someone needs Jesus in their life, guess what? Their life's going to be a little complicated. You're going to run into setbacks, but we can't give up. We can't pack our bags and go home. They need to encounter what we've encountered, the grace and the beauty of Jesus, and we need to encounter what it's like for the power of grace to move through us. I just want you to know, grace finds a way. Grace finds a way past crowded schedules. Grace finds a way through complicated relationships. Grace finds a way. I'm with you. You know what? I've run into a million people, and you're trying to get them, and you know, there's different things, and I'm like, hey man, you ought to come to Sunday. And they're like, man, Sundays are tough for me. And it's like, okay, cool. You know, you ought to come to a man challenge or real woman with me. I don't go to real men. You know what I'm saying? And they're like, you know, I don't really do mornings. They do a nighttime. I don't really do nighttime. And then you're like, okay, hey, bro, you ought to come over for dinner. I don't eat. And I'm like, you are lying now. You're just, come on, man. You're not even trying, right? Grace overcomes obstacles. But then lastly, grace breaks through ceilings. And I love this. You know, I don't know if you know this. I'm sure you do. Sacrifice and faith are the fuel of grace. Did you hear me? Sacrifice and faith are the fuel of grace. And when we really believe that Jesus can do what only Jesus can do, do you know what we do? We clean the house once a week. We pay for the dinner, even though it costs us something, because we know what happens when people sit at our table. We do the mountain of dishes. We clean the house the next day. Because that's what grace does. We don't just sit in church asking for more and more and more grace, more and more. We go out and we give it away like it's free. And we give love, and we give forgiveness, and we give acceptance, which, by the way, might be the very best way to actually find more. And I love this. In Acts chapter 4, it says, with great power, the apostles continue to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace, hear this, was so powerfully at work in them that there were no more needy people among them. Not a single one. Because grace had come to them and they felt it and it was real. And then grace started working in them so powerfully that what? It had to come through them. There's no way for this to stop. It has to come out. It has to pop out. It's got to break through the ceiling. We're this close. Have you ever run into a ceiling? My wife and I have. I'm just gonna be honest. I never know whether or not to share things like this, but I'm just gonna do this. But probably last June, in 1 month, we had Sarah's sister who decided to be a missionary in Poland, which is awesome and incredible, and we believe in what God's gonna do in them. And then one of my best friends from San Diego, who's a church planner, comes to me and says, hey, we're moving, and we're going out of the country, and we're gonna go down to the Dominican Republic, and we're gonna plant churches all over, and I know what God's gonna do through his life. But then Sarah and I looked at ourselves, and we said, man, but here's our problem. We have a ceiling. We want to help. We want to be a part of God's grace going to places that it's never been. We want to, but we have a ceiling. My wife and I began to have this kind of growing conviction, I guess is how I say it, that we needed to somehow, I don't know how, get the financial position where we could just be more generous. We just kept doing this. We knew the only way that grace could flow through us was going to be we're gonna have to make some sacrifices. We're gonna have to make some changes. Something's gotta give. The ceiling's gotta come off. So, house went on the market in October, and we have been homeless looking for a house since January. And I think that's what grace does. So what's keeping, you know who those people are in your life that need grace. What's keeping them? I mean, is there any way we could just give more of our time or more of our resources or care less about our reputation? Is it possible we allow the grace that came to us again at great cost? The Father had to cover a great distance, had to overcome a whole bunch of obstacles. And in the cross and the resurrection, he tore open the roof so that you and I could taste it. But what if it grew in us? And what if that grace moved through us? Like the gospel writers would say, grace in the beginning, grace in the middle, and grace through us till the end. Who needs grace? Dear Heavenly Father, God, there's nobody like you, and we love you. And today, this morning, we are humbled by your grace. To us, we don't deserve it. But Father, grace keeps going. And not only do we need you to meet us in our mess right now, and the reality that even though we know about grace, we still fail, and we still need your grace today. But Father, we're asking, would you give us the great privilege of seeing, experiencing, watching your grace move through us? Father, we want to know what it's like to cover a great distance, to overcome the obstacles,
and to break through ceilings so that we can even more understand, even more appreciate what you have done for us in Jesus. Use us, Father. Allow grace to reign in our lives. We pray that in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, y'all, if you are here this morning and you've never tasted that kind of grace, I hope you know this is a place that we will always get groups of people, and we will always help you get to Jesus. So if you know you need grace today, but you're not sure how, and you're not sure what to do, and you're not sure where to go, I'll tell you right now. You just come down from wherever you are, and you make your way up here, and we will get you to Jesus. But for some of you, you've been floating, and you've been trying to find a church home, and you're floating. Here's your sign. Put your roots down. Help us give grace to this city. Would you help us? Join. Hop into the family and say, we are not just a people who sit. We are a people where the grace goes through us. This is my home, and let's go. But maybe you just need prayer, and this weekend's been rough, and the last week, we love. If any of those things are true, why don't you just meet me down here, and we'll get you to Jesus, all right? And just, why don't you just stand with us as we worship and as we sing.